talking tonight a little bit about Samson. I don't know how many remembers about Samson, but he was a vessel that God had used. And it was in the Old Testament. If you go to Judges, if you want to read it, you can go, when you go home, you can read it. But his mom and dad, an angel of the Lord appeared to his mom and his dad and told them, an angel came to him and told them that they was going to have a son, and he was going to be a Nazarite. And a Nazarite was not supposed to have any strong drinks, wine, or anything else. He wasn't allowed to cut their hair or anything else. But that angel came to him and told his wife, and she went and told that husband and said, "The angel of the Lord came unto me." And so he said, "Well, I want to talk to the angel of the Lord." And so she went and talked to the angel. And then Manoah knew that he was an angel of the Lord. Her husband, after he had then seen that angel, he knew that was an angel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't know how many knows, but you know God still got them angels. And they do appear, and they do help people. They protect them and everything else. But Manoah and his wife, they knew they was going to have a son. And she was going to call his name Samuel. Lord help me. And the woman bare a son and called his name Samson. And the child grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move him at times in the camp of Dan between Zorah and Eshtaol. And at this time, the Philistines was controlling, and they had control over the Israelites. And the Israelites was being tormented, they was being put down, they was being persecuted and everything else. But you know what, Samson, he wanted to take and do his own thing. We got people today that wants to do their own thing. But you know what, he went into the Philistines and he went down and found a woman that he wanted to take to his wife. And he asked his father if he would go down there and get him a wife, and he went down there, and he got this woman, and they made a feast, but he wasn't supposed to drink any wine or strong drink. But I'm telling you, God's got Samson, and I'm going to go by the Holy Spirit, God's got Samson in the body of Christ today. It might not be like that Samson, and you know, we've got some people that is called to the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're not really walking where they want to walk, but God said he's going to begin to call them out. He's going to begin to bring them out and bring them back where they were supposed to be from even in as a young child. He said, when you begin to lift up your eyes and look, he's going to begin to minister even unto you. Samson, he was a man of God for a while, but he went down into the Philistines. He got a wife that wasn't even of his nationality, but you know what? God still used him. He went and fell and everything else. But God said, "I'm going to use you," and he began to lift him up. And he began to lift him up, and he went and took the jawbone, and the Philistines was killing him and everything else, and he turned. And when he was going back, he was going to go for a feast. And when he began to go back, and he went and killed a lion, and he gave him a riddle, and he told him this riddle about this. It was a lion, and there was a swarm of bees was in it, and the honey was in the carcass of the dead lion. And
amen.
Lord, I'm asking you to help tonight. We've got a lot of Samsons that's out there in the field. And it might not be like the Samson, but we've got a lot of Samsons. And we've got a lot of people, and I'm not talking just not men, but I'm talking the women, the children, the boys and the girls. We've got them out there in the highways and the hedges. This Samson, he followed God for a while. He'd done many things. At one time, he took the jawbone of a donkey when he was serving God, and he killed over 1,000 Philistines with that little jawbone of that donkey. And you know, he had that anointing upon him, and he began to move like God wanted him to move. And I'm telling you, we've got some Samsons out there in this field, out there in the highways and in the hedges and in the side. begin to commit your life on the Lord Jesus Christ, your life is going to turn around. It might be in a turmoil. You might be in a battle. You might be in something you can't get out of. You might be in bondage to something. But I'm telling you, when you're going to be like Samson and turn your life around and begin to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, those battles, them addictions or whatever else it might be that's upon you, God will begin to break them. He'll begin to pull them down and he will set you free like you've never been set free before. You know what? God has got you. He's got you in his hands. And even in the Bible, you know what? God looked at them when he was walking this earth, when Jesus was walking this earth. He looked at them people that was going down the streets. He looked at that one young man that was in that casket and this mother was crying and crying and everything else. And they was taking him and going to bury him. You know what? He spoke to that young man that was in that casket and was dead. And he spoke life to him and he come alive. God wants to begin to speak life into your life like he's never done before. He wants to begin to lift you up like he's never done before. He wants to break those yokes and those chains and those bodies. And there's things that's got a hold of you. But as you go and read through this, it starts when you go home and wherever you're at. Judges about the 15th chapter and on for the next couple, three chapters. I won't go through them tonight, but I'm telling you, when you begin to call on Jesus Christ, he's going to answer you like he's never done before. Because God has got you in the palm of his hand. I thank God for what he has done. I thank you, Jesus, that he is going to deliver, and I have even some of my families. I have some that we need to pray for. And God is saying, when you begin to seek me and search for me, you will find him. That's enough. He said, you will find him. It's like that woman that went to that well. She was thirsty, and she was wanting something to drink. And how many people do we see out there? My heart weeps and it breaks for those that is outside that doesn't know my Jesus. And when I see him, my heart breaks and I begin to pray, God, please deliver them. Please deliver them and set them free. And if we as a body and as a church and as a believer, if we don't begin to get down to do business with the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to lose them. You can see it in the paper. You can hear it over the news. We've got all kinds of young people dying from ODs. And I'm telling you, we need to get down to business with the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, call on me and you will find me. All I know is this is what I wanted to do tonight. I want to teach about Samson, but it breaks my heart. It breaks my heart when I see the teenagers going down the streets and I see what's on television. And I pray, and when I pray in my room, intercessory prayer, I cry unto God, set them free. Break them into your kingdom and set them free and break the yokes that's got a hold of them. Because if we don't begin to call on him and begin to seek him like we've never sought him before, we're not going to be able to see him make heaven their home. And God's calling the people to come out. He said the harvest is already white. The harvest is already white. And he said he's going to begin to call people into the harvest. He said, I'm going to send you into the highways and the hedges. And I pray God send the people into the highways and into the hedges, just not in the church building. But he's looking for people that's going to come out of the church and begin to go out and begin to bring them into the kingdom of God. He wants you to begin to bring them into the kingdom of God. Have you talked to someone this last week about Jesus? Have you called on him? Have you talked to him? And I'm telling you, when you begin to lift up your eyes and you look to my Jesus, you're going to see something happening, not only in somebody else's life, but in your life. He wants you to begin to call on him like you've never done before.
Amen.
And when he was here, he told his disciples to go out two by two. Because you know what? They needed the support of one another. He needs you to go out and begin to compel them to come into the kingdom of God. Not just a church building. A church building does not save you, but we need the churches to bring them into, to begin to feed them and begin to nurture them and begin to bring them into the kingdom like they need to be. And if you go back into Ezekiel about the 40th chapter, when Ezekiel had that vision, there was a valley full of dry bones in that valley down in about 37th chapter in there someplace in the Old Testament. And when you begin to look and begin to see what happened in that vision, you know what? He looked and there was all these bones. There was no meat, there was no sinew, there wasn't nothing on them bones of all these people that was in that vision that he seen in this valley. And when you look around, we've got valleys out here in this land and in the world, and the bones are dry, there's no meat, there's nothing on them. They don't have anything to nurture them, they don't have no life, they're dead because they're dead in their trespasses and sins. They don't know Jesus Christ because of what Adam done in that garden. But you know what? As he looked around, and he began to speak life to them bones. When he began to speak life to your bones, and I'm telling you, I'm going another way with this tonight, but I'm going to begin to speak life to your bones. You've been in that valley. Your life has been dry. You have been hungry. You've been thirsty. You've tried this. You've tried the needle. You've tried this. You've tried everything else. You've tried everything that you could try, but your bones are dry, and you're in that valley, and there's no life left in you. There's nothing that you can do by yourself, but I'm telling you, my Jesus is going to come along like in that vision which he had in that valley. And when he began to see them bones, he began to speak life unto them bones. And when Ezekiel began to speak life unto them bones, they began to get flesh and sinew upon them bones. And you know what happened? Them bones begin to make a person, they begin to rise up. And I'm telling you, you know what happened in that vision? God put life, he spoke life into them bones, and they stood up and they became an army for the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you tonight, I'm going to speak to you, whoever is listening in here, I'm speaking life onto your dead bones, and that you're going to begin to get the flesh, and that's the meat of the word from the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to begin to seek after him like you've never sought before, and I pray that God will put an anointing upon you, and you'll get so hungry you can't get your nose out of that Bible. You need to get the word of God. You need to begin to seek him like you've never sought him before. You've sought everything else. You look for everything else, and God said when you begin to call on him, he's going to begin to answer. But Ezekiel, and back in the Old Testament, you know what? They came alive. They literally come alive. And you know what? God's body's going to come back alive like it did when I was young. I seen many miracles. I seen the deaf ears open. I seen the blind eyes open. I seen many things happen to me when I was a child and when I was young. But we're going to begin to see the ones that's in the bondage. And I pray, if you don't pray, I pray you start getting a burden to pray like you've never prayed before, that you begin to seek God for yourself. Get your Bible off. Get your Bible open. You get this Word of God open and you begin to seek it for yourself. Don't let somebody else do it for you. They can't bring you in. But I'm telling you, you need to get Jesus Christ and you need to know who he is and everything else about him. But I'm telling you, them bones are going to come alive. Your life is going to begin to change like it's never changed before, because he's calling you for such a time as this. Even as he called John, even as he called Peter, even as he called David in the Old Testament. David was a mighty man of God. He fell, but you know what? God still loved him. He repented of what he had done when he had Delilah's. The man soldiers, his wife that got killed, he had him killed, but he repented, and it said he was a man after God's own heart. I'm telling you, when you begin to seek my Jesus, when you begin to call on him, he's going to answer you like you've never been answered before. But he wants you to begin to call on him. He wants you to begin to seek after him like you've never done before. Jesus. Lord, I thank you for what you have done. I thank you for what you're going to do, but God, I just pray, even if it didn't come out like I thought it should, I know that you've got it in the palm of your hands. And God, I thank you for those that's going to watch it, that's going to see it on YouTube, I pray right now that you will touch their hearts, that you will touch the Holy Spirit, and that you will begin to speak to their hearts and begin to pull them in, and that you will begin to direct their steps, Father, and Lord, that you will begin to feed them and bring people across their path and begin to show them like they've never been shown before. And God, I thank you for what you're going to do, but God, I thank you right now for what you've already done. I thank you, Jesus, for each and everything, Father. I thank you that when you went to that cross and you hadn't paid the price for all mankind, when you hung up on that cross and when he was on that cross, he seen all the people around, they was mocking him, they were ridiculing. The one soldier took a spear and he went and pushed it in his side, and when that blood and that water come out, the church was literally birthed. You and I was literally birthed, and he paid the price on Calvary. He took those stripes upon his back. 39 stripes he took upon his back. You know what he took the 39 stripes for on his back? That was for your healing. That was for my healing. That is for anybody that has a need in the body that needs a healing, not only in the flesh, but in the mind, in the spirit realm. When you need a healing, God is right there, and he will do it, and he will answer it, just like he answered David, just like he answered the apostles. He talked to Peter. He talked to James, he talked to John, he talked to all of them. He's going to begin to talk to you like he talked to them. And I'm telling you, buckle up your seatbelt, because you're going to go forth in the kingdom of God like you've never went before, because he's calling on people that will stand up, that will stand up and take a stand for him like they've never done before. He's looking for people that will be like what Jimmy Martin used to say, a backbone like a saw log that will not bend. You won't bend here, you won't bend there, but you'll stand. And whenever everything comes against you, you will stand, because God's going to give you strength like you've never had in your back, in your spirit, man. You're going to begin to stand like you've never ever stood before. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He paid a price that no man could pay. No man could pay it. I couldn't pay it. You couldn't pay it. But yet he was there. Just like Samson. And you know what? He fell. He went and got a woman of the Philistines, got a wife of the Philistines who was an Israelite. And it was ordained of God. You know what they done to him? If you want to read it when you go home, when you leave here, read about what they done to Samson. They cut his hair off, and his hair, as a Nazarite, was not supposed to cut their hair, was not supposed to drink wine or strong drink. Well, he did that, and Delilah, she went and got him, and she found a secret of his strength. She bribed him different times and said, well, he said, if you tie me up in these ropes and everything else, and he said, there, I'll lose my strength. Well, he broke loose, and she tried some other things, and he broke the rope, and he broke them. And she said, if you really love me, you'll tell me why, how you get your strength. He finally fell, and he surrendered to her and told her, if you cut my hair, because he's a Nazarite, I'll lose my strength. She called him because he was sleeping and had his head in her lap. And sometimes we put our heads in somebody else's laps. We don't need to have our heads in, spiritually speaking. And Samson, and she woke him up, and these men came in, and they had cut his hair off while he was sleeping. He lost all of his strength. And I'm telling you something, when you don't walk with God, you will lose your strength in the spiritual realm. But God wants to restore your strength in the kingdom of God. He wants you to come back to him like you've never ever come back to him before. And I'm telling you, you know what they've done to him? They tortured him. They took him because they took, I don't know don't know what they done with, but they literally took and gouged his eyes out that he could not see. And then they had these, and they used the horses and everything to grind and walk around and grind the grain and everything else. They put him on one of them, and they had him walking just like an animal to grind the grain and everything else. He went through literal hell, physically speaking, but I'm telling you something. He prayed and asked God to let him have his strength back one more time. And I'm telling you, when you begin to pray and ask God, he's going to restore your strength back like he did for Samson. He will restore your strength and give it back to you like it has never been before. You know what? And they was had this Colosseum which held thousands and thousands and thousands of people. And there was two big pillars. If you read, go back and when you go home, read the pillars. And he asked the one young lad, because he couldn't see anymore. And his hair was beginning to grow back. And it was coming back, and it was coming back. And he knew God. He said, God, let me do one more thing. Give me the strength to restore the Philistines that tortured and put the Israelite people down. You know what? He said to the one lad, he said, here, where's the one pillar? He got a hold of the one pillar, and he asked that young lad, he said, where's the other pillar? He put his arm around that other pillar, and he talked to God, and you know what he did? He began to pull, and he not only died, but he pulled them pillars, and then thousands of people that was in that Colosseum and watching it was literally destroyed, and he got killed. But in that last moment of his life, when he come back to the Lord Jesus Christ, he killed more at that one incident that happened in his life than happened throughout his whole life of the Philistines that he had killed previously. He literally destroyed more and killed more at that one time when he made that final dedication to the Lord God Almighty. I'm telling you, when you come back to your God, when you come back to your Savior, you know what? You're going to destroy more enemies than you've ever did in the past. You might have got two or three killed in the past, but I'm telling you, you're going to be like a Samson. You're going to begin to stand up, and you're going to begin to go forth like a mighty lion, and he's going to begin to restore everything the enemy has taken back from you. And I don't know if you got anything out of it, but so be it. Bless you. I'm going to go ahead.